And I didn't realize it. I had an extra one, and then I found it, and I'm like, oh, I'm going to give that to you. This year we have a lot of them. Oh, so you're looking for... Oh, okay. We have, like, well, there's the pink, you know, ribbon. We have that, and then we have, okay. I don't know if I have that or whatever. Yeah. And we have new, like, inscription ones where you can do it, like, custom. Like, if you wanted something that we didn't have, we can custom grade the, like, the plates and some of the backs are solid, like, if you wanted to that's a newer in the last 6 months or so. And then we have, like, for teacher, we have, like the owls and the books. And then a pencil one. There's a school bus, but that may be, like, more for me to see. And yeah, I have a, like, like large silver markets that are sort of this size. They're silver with the blue of the crystals.
We might have to move
it. Open like this one, like an inch. Those are, that's cool.
For some reason, mine keeps jumping back to the November meeting, but I finally got the December one.
It's 28. It's like, for what you get, I don't think it's quite so kind of big for your buck. Hi, Trent. Hey, how are you?
No wonder. The purple of the minute.
You got your quota.
Yeah, like, I jumped to the extreme.
I'd like to welcome you all to our board meeting this evening. I don't know which clock to go by. The clock behind you is a little fast, and the clock in front of you is a little slow. So we'll average it out and get started. Again, we'd like to welcome you. Our agenda is posted on each side of the room for your reference. And we will start the meeting this evening by a piano presentation by Shannon Huntsman from Orion Junior High. And when she is finished, she is going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. So, Shannon, we turn the time over to you. We have never had someone that did the Pledge of Allegiance or presented it that had the audience stand right there. That was absolutely incredible, exceptional. Thank you so much. First item of business board is our consent calendar. Do I have a motion to approve the consent calendar? Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion passes. We will start now with our recognitions, and we'd like to turn the time over to Bill Griddles. Bill?
Thank you, Fred, Superintendent, and Board. Fred, could you come up, please? This is Fred Smith, Digital Media at Fremont High, and tonight you're going to be receiving the I Love Teaching Award, so be patient. I've got some nice things to say about you. First, we stole Fred from KJAS. He was a production guy at KJAS, and Mr. Newey found him down there interviewing him, and we hired him. And when I met with Fred, he said that he just enjoyed training people, and he thought teaching, and people had told him he'd be a good teacher, and that he has become, for sure. Fred teaches, again, digital media classes, and he's responsible for the PAC TV at Fremont High School. He's also the head girls soccer coach. They've won several region championships, and if you had a chance to watch them this year, they were spectacular. He took third place in state, lost a tough one to the eventual champs, Davis High, and then Davis went on to beat Weaver, so we had two teams that are, you do a great job with your kids. They're fundamentally sound, and they're fun to play, or to watch. They play very hard. Your principal, Mr. Belknap, says that you're an outstanding teacher, and you care deeply and passionately about what you teach and your students. Each year, Fred helps organize projects school-wide and for the district that are much needed. He also says that we learn from someone we don't learn from someone we don't like. And Fred is someone kids learn from because kids love you at Fremont High School. And that's quite a compliment. Assistant Superintendent Newey, all three of his kids had Fred's classes. They took digital media. In fact, his middle son, Luke, used what he learned in your class to put a video together to be nominated for a $100,000 scholarship opportunity with Dr. Pepper. This was 2 years ago?
Last year.
So his video was off the chart, and he got the opportunity to go compete at the Big Ten Championship game in Indianapolis. And thank goodness that Mr. Newey's wife is athletic, because he ended up winning. He won a $100,000 scholarship to help him get through BYU. But Mr. Newey thanks you for what you did to make Luke so proficient in digital media. So that was really cool. Couple quotes from some of your kids, if you don't mind, Fred. This is, you remember Kelsey Maples, I'm sure. Kelsey says, Mr. Smith understands what kids want to see and hear. He knows what is popular and entertaining to us kids. He is easy to listen to and makes class fun and memorable. I know I want to go into a career with media, and I know that I'm actually prepared. Unlike most high schools, we broadcast live. We actually use technology that is up to date. We learn how to use the skills that will help us if we want a future in broadcasting. He's definitely made an impact on me deciding what career path I want to take. And then I got another one here. Braden was going to come in tonight, and he wanted to speak to you, but he had a job interview. So yesterday he called and said he couldn't make it. But he said, Mr. Smith has been one of the most influential teachers I have ever had. Ever since my first TV broadcasting class in 10th grade, he sparked a fire in me that inspired a passion for filming that I never knew I had. Mr. Smith saw my potential and showed me the way to be the best video, to make the best videos I could make. He continues to help me today. He supports my ideas to make them a reality. Without Mr. Smith, I would not make the quality videos I do now, have the knowledge about digital media that I do, or the passion to continue on in a career in film and digital media. He says, please thank Mr. Smith for all he has done. You are the best teacher he's ever had. So he's a great kid. And I was in his class, and the kids are all so comfortable. He's talking to me, and the kid raises his hand. Hey, they had some music going. And as he's talking to me, he goes, hey, no, that's not going to work with what you're doing. Pull up this YouTube, do this. It was just, you were just so in tune with all the kids. And then the last thing they do is 2 years ago, Mr. Belknap and Fred started as a Fremont Spirit video. They go out and in one day they video every single kid in the school. And they're on a video and they show it all during homecoming. So I'm just going to show you 2 minutes of a clip, but this is the coolest thing and it kind of highlights every kid at Fremont High. So Trent.
So say what you run home, 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 say what you run home.
Kick the dust up.
Funny in that video is, and you guys have all heard of Where's Waldo? Well, I was watching this video this whole week. Well, Rod, Mr. Belknap's in there about four times. Once he's milking a cow, he runs in and gives you one of these. And it was the craziest thing. Great job. So, Superintendent Board, Fred Smith, I love teaching at work.
That's why I'm here, so thank you.
Twitter. You want to get in this one too, right?
It's my pleasure this evening to present to you Carrie Pilot. What a privilege it is for us to have her in our district. This is what, when you go into to Weaver Innovation Center, Weaver Innovation High School, this is the smile that you're always met with. And something that I found, and Mr. Smith alluded to it a little bit, I get the privilege of usually being the one who goes out and lets recipients know that they're getting an award. And I found something with the best of them. And Fred mentioned it. This is what we had with Fred. This is what we had with Carrie. And I would refer to it as humble gratitude. They look at it and they are so humble and they are so grateful. And that was exactly the case that we had with Fred as well as Carrie. And this is what Carrie mentioned when she was notified. She says, I have the privilege of being with a great group of people who all work to make this happen. And we see that looking at the whole picture and who else is involved. And that certainly is the attitude that Carrie has. Now, something else that I notice is their co-workers always aren't as humble. You can tell that they get excited, and these are some of the things that some of Carrie's co-workers said. What a deserving honor for Carrie. She is a gem that shines bright at the school. And then, hardly able to contain their exuberance, yay, this is so well deserved. Go, Carrie. So, as I've gotten to talk with people and to get to know a little bit more about Carrie, I would describe two characteristics that are obvious that you have. One is that she's competent, and the other one is that she's caring. And almost every quote, everybody that we talked to, this came up about how caring and how competent you are. I'd like to just go over and take a little time and go over some of the things that were said about you, Carrie. I don't think, have you seen this yet? Okay. It is such an honor and a privilege that we get to have Carrie as our secretary of Weaver Innovation. She is always going out of her way to take care of things. Carrie seems to always be doing the work of five people all at once. Now, with that, there's always a lot of things that take place with new employees when we open a new school. But when we open a new elementary, usually we already have the guide on what an elementary teacher does. When we open up a secondary school, we know what the registrar, we know what the attendance clerk, we know what the head secretary does. With Weaver Innovation, it was a new script. And Carrie just jumped in to that new script and has been with all of those different positions and has just taken ownership and done an amazing job. She is multitask queen and is usually two steps ahead of problems and questions. She is so smart, comes up with the best solutions for all situations. She goes the extra mile to find the information we need. She always says hi with a smile and sets the tone to have a great day. Carrie sincerely cares about all of Weaver Innovation students and staff members. She takes the time to build a positive relation among all whom she comes in contact with. Carrie always brightens my day every time I walk into work. Again, that smile when you enter the office. She is absolutely amazing at everything she does for students and staff. I am convinced that Carrie is the best of the best, and we are so lucky to have her at Weaver Innovation. We also have, so those are what the co-workers said, but here are some kids there at Weaver Innovation, and they actually wrote their messages on the board. And again, that competent and caring attitude, best secretary a school can have. Super helpful understanding. The school is lucky to have her. You know, with what kids go through, how nice to always know that there's somebody that's understanding. She's super duper sweet, caring, pretty. She can bring a smile to anyone's face. I adore her very much. And that's Maeve that said that. And then, you know, some of the other things, I think with her administration, with having Hal Raymond and Reed and myself, you know, we're not too concerned about Aaron always being on point, but, you know, that's, Ethan made that observation. Just the students love her, and that was obvious, too. Mr. Newey had me make the announcement during lunch, and those kids, you would have thought that I was giving them the award the way that they responded. Would like to read something that Mr. Newey, the principal there at Weaver Innovation High School, said. He writes, "I have seen many individuals do some amazing things for this school district. This past year, I've witnessed Carrie Pilot build a school from the ground up that has been amazing. She has handled all the many processes and problems, like she does everything, with grace, patience, and complete professional competence. As an administrator, I really don't have to worry about problems or issues because I know that Carrie can and will handle it. Carrie Pilot is a professional and she behaves as one in every situation and under all circumstances. We could never make it without her. She is an amazing person, a great friend to all, and very deserving nominee for the Extra Mile Award. So board, with that, I would like to present to you Carrie Pilot for the Extra Mile Award. I think we'd just like to
This is my husband back here taking a picture, Steve Pilot. My boys wanted to come tonight, but they're both at the University of Utah in school and couldn't make it. They have lacrosse practice and other stuff going on tonight. So, but this is just wonderful. I mean, I never expected this, and I don't see myself doing anything unique. I just go to work and do the best job I can because I work at the best place and I work with the best people. I mean, Mr. Newey has brought together some of the best people to work with. You know, we get along great. You know, my counselor Christy is back here, and you know, we work as a team. You know, we wouldn't be able to do it as just one person. We work as a team and get it done together. So, but I really appreciate this. Thank you so much.
Let's let's get into again, show our appreciation for Carrie Weiss. We are now going to move into the action item portion of our agenda. I'm sorry, we have a presentation. Thank you, Jeff. Let's turn the time over to Marilyn.
Board and Superintendent, yes, I'm so excited to be here again tonight. You got to hear some wonderful things about Chris Ferrario last month. She's received our I Love Teaching Award as a language pathologist over at Canyon View. Tonight, she and Andrea Roseberry are going to do a presentation on one of the pilot programs that they have going there. They're working with preschool students and their speech and language development. And we work with some amazing people in our district. I mean, we're pretty lucky to have such incredible educators. But as great as they are with the kids, what's really amazing about this program is they're also teaching the parents along with the kids. So you know how we're really excited when, you know, we can help to get parents active and involved in their students' education? Well, they're doing it right alongside the parents. So I can't wait for you to hear more about this program.
Thanks. This is, the microphone alone is intimidating. Dr. Stevens and board, thank you so much for this awesome opportunity. This is a big deal for Andrea and I. This is Andrea Roseberry and I'm Chris Ferrario. I'm a speech language pathologist, works at Canview School, elementary school. And Andrea is our speech language technician. We're cohorts, partners in crime. We work together on this program. Andrea is gonna take a second to just give you some background about our program.
First off, as kind of part background, we actually piloted it 3 years ago, and in part thanks to Marilyn for giving us the opportunity and the support to go ahead and give it a run and give it a try to see what parents thought of it, and also for Rachel Troughton. She's the one that came to a handful of us with the vision and to Marilyn with the initiative to get something started that would teach these parents and train them how to do some of the practice at home that they get to do. And then also our principal, and I don't see her tonight, Jennifer, she helps a ton making sure that we have the space available that we need to run our program, to make sure that we can get our setup taken care of quickly and efficiently. And then also, of course, acknowledgement to an amazing leader and innovator, by the name of Barbara Hodson, who initially came up with the idea of the cycles approach that we do use. She's a leader of ongoing research and treatment for developmental phonology with speech sounds, and continues to practice what she's taught and what she's publishing at Wichita State University.
Awesome. So we were thinking about how to best share this program that we do every week, once a week for 60 minutes. With you, and we decided that we would be best told through the words of a parent. So, in our next slide, sorry, thanks, bud. This is a note from Aubrey, one of our parents, and she's a mother of a Weber County School District student, and she's also, on the next click, our student.
We began this journey with just 2 to 3 words in our son's language. He would try to communicate, but we just couldn't understand him. Instead of knowing how to express himself, he would scream. It was exhausting and frustrating. I remember one particular day that was hard. He couldn't tell me what he wanted, so he screamed and cried at the top of his lungs. He was angry, hurt, and frustrated. All I could do was just drive home, and by the time I hit the driveway, he had given up and fell asleep in his car seat. I bawled as I carried him inside. I knew that I needed help. More help than I was getting. After praying my 1,000th prayer to God for help and guidance, we were evaluated and were a good fit for PACT. This group is not convenient. It takes a lot of work, effort, time, and dedication, but it is worth it. I've seen changes and huge improvements in the first few weeks. I love this program because of the progress my son has made. He rarely is frustrated anymore. He's gained confidence in his speech and will talk. He knows that he can say something and I will understand him. That in itself is a huge reward for me. We have had so much fun together since we started. It has been said that you love those you serve the very most, and I can attest that it is true. I am so very, very proud of my son and all his hard work, and look forward to another cycle with him and seeing just how far we can improve together. I feel so blessed to be a part of this group. It has changed our lives. Thank you.
So that's really the words of one parent, but really of many, that we get to participate with in our program and journey through together. When we were looking back at our program and how we felt like we wanted to talk to you as a board and in the community, as a district, we wanted to visit our mission statement. And in reviewing our mission statement, the word that jumped out at us was motivate. And motivation is really the key in a lot of learning. It's really critical with 3 to 5 year olds learning, because if they're not motivated and excited about it, a lot's not gonna happen that day, right? But what we've also seen is there's motivation in the parents and the grandparents and the fathers and the babysitters. It's not just one mom coming each session. It takes the village, and each family often contributes with multiple family members that come in. We are seeing that the parents and children are motivated through the vision of our district's mission statement, and that's exciting that we go back and visit our mission. Let me share some more with you. Our mission is being accomplished. We decided, we felt comfortable with it. We also wanted to really access our community, our taxpayer, our Weber School District parent. And we asked a survey monkey question. If given the opportunity to rewind time and choose again to attend these classes, I would most likely, and this is where you have to hold your breath because there's 7 options and you're not sure what they're gonna pick. But it was pretty cool. I didn't expect 100%, but we did. We got 100% of the parents that took our surveys would definitely do this again and would highly recommend it to other children and parents that can attend. So we felt very confident that what Andrea and I and a lot of my mentors felt, this we're on the right track. The parents are happy, and the kids are making improvements, we're feeling good about it. So let me tell you more about PACT. Parent and child-centered therapy, that triangle is critical. It's an evidence-based treatment and a service and delivery model. Andrea mentioned it earlier about Barbara Hodson. We're not just throwing darts in the dark here. We're definitely using some evidence-based treatment. But our model, we feel like we have some really good bones to it. We took a look at 3 to 6 year olds. We're at our third year of implementation. It's a bit of a risk for Marilyn, my boss, because it takes her salary and my salary in an hour to work with one set of kids. And it's a bit of a gamble because that's a lot of worker output. But what we decided, we could work with 5 parents and 5 kids in 1 hour, and let's see if we can get some synergy going. It seems to be working really well. Right now we run 2 groups back to back. We have another clinician in the district who also runs groups as well. And then on the next slide, here's what it looks like. 60 minutes and one time a week. I'll walk you through the session. It's about practice, 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 practice. We're not wasting any time. Whole group gets together. We talk about our sound. We usually are very literacy-based, so we're reading or singing, we do some rhymes. Then we break into a small group, then the parent and the child work together, then we break into another small group, and then we come back together as a large group, and if you haven't gotten it by then, you're going to get it for sure, and then we walk out the door with homework. Parents know what their homework is, kids know what's expected of them. If there's any questions, it's discussed right there, and they head home. All we ask of the parents is 3 minutes a day. Do you have 3 minutes a day? Okay, then we're gonna get some progress, right? And our PACT program, these are the bones that I think are important. And it was kind of neat because I went back and did research. We kind of did it backwards. Rachel set it up for us, but when we worked it backwards, we had some key components that we felt were important. And it was nice to go to other research studies and find out
other important people are doing the same things. So some of the important things we found that are critical to our program is our kids get 100 trials per session. That means they're practicing 100 times, or they're hearing the target 100 times, which is a lot. You know how I know we're reaching it? The parents are keeping data. I don't like to keep data. I like to work with kids. And so the parents are actually keeping the data and keeping track of how often the target is being perceived or the target is being produced. That's exciting for Andrea and I, because we can get going and we don't know if we're on target or not. We pull out our data sheets and we've got a lot of tally marks. As a matter of fact, we have a bell ringer. You know the, well, what do they call it? Staples button.
That was easy.
Yeah, that was easy. So that was easy, but. So, and you can also just look up there at the board at some of the important aspects of it. Another thing that's really critical, I think, is that it's fun and it's parent-centered. And the way it's fun is that it's achievable. So our kids are always setting out achievable targets that we know they can do. Luckily, we take our professional experience and background to make sure that they're successful. And it's always about baby steps forward and baby steps backward. And training the parent, too, because often I'm a parent, too. As soon as my kid makes the leap, I want to make a giant leap, right? And we have to continually pull the reins back and pull the parent back and say, let's meet them where they're at, make them successful there, and keep coming back to the table again and again and again. So it's really, really exciting parent-centered approach. So finally, on the last part of our journey, we really want to look down the road. We really want to be accountable to our taxpayers, to the board, to our community members, and say, we think this is feeling good, but let's take a look at this. So Rachel's going to help us out and look down the road and follow these kids longitudinally and see if have we positively decreased treatment time from referral to dismissal. In our mission statement, I did take note of it. We aspire to expedite the remediation process so that more of our students can achieve academic and personal potential by spending more time in the classroom setting and less time in the therapy setting. So as therapists, we want them out of our therapy room and we want them into our classroom. And we're going to follow these kids and see if they get out into that classroom a little bit more often. And the second measure would be, have we positively impacted reading fluency and comprehension by avoiding intensive instructional needs? There's a direct link between these kids' speech and how well they read. And we want to make sure that they're in the classroom, they're reading effectively with less intervention strategies so they can be successful as part of our mission statement. So thank you so much for this unique opportunity to share our passion about phonology. Thanks you guys for so much. Part of this process. We sat down as a team, several of us, and did feel that there were some important identifying factors to make this successful. And not to get too clinical with you, but these kids do have specific needs with phonological processing, speech pattern production, their language is intact, their cognition is fairly within the developmentally appropriate age or level, and their behaviors are there. The other big part is, can a parent bring them? Can a parent actually take time out of the day and get a sitter? We are demanding, and it's really exciting because I tell them about this program and how excited I am for them to get here, and they get sitters. They make a difference. They grab a mother. I have a lot of grandmas that come. So attendance is critical, and I have to be honest with you, we're real upfront with our parents, and they come to us with notes like Aubrey's, and we say, well, we're willing to help, but we're going to have to, it's going to be tough. And are you willing to put in the time? And they say, yes, I am. And really, we've been very, very successful. The only kids who have been successful in our program have essentially moved out and left. So we did have some critical identifying elements to get them into the program to make sure that they were successful to move through. That's a great question. Thank you. Anything else?
Again, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Marilyn, thank you. Okay, now we will move to our action items. We're going to turn the time over to Robert Peterson for our independent auditor's report. Robert.
Thank you, President. We
have come to the end of our audit, and actually it was finished a while back, but it's in a reportable format, and we have our auditors here from Squire & Company. This is the first year they've been with us as we went out to bid and switched auditors last year. And we have Matt Geddes, raise your hand, Matt. And we also have Ray Bartholomew. And they have been outstanding to work with, and we've really appreciated their efforts and also their expertise. We also have with us Seth Pilkington, Assistant Business Administrator. Seth is also relatively new. He's been here a year now, or a little over a year. And Seth has been outstanding. And what I'd like to do is just turn the time over to Ray, and he'll briefly, in 5 minutes or less, because we've had a committee, the audit committee's met. We met on Monday. We also had a review session at 4 o'clock that board members and the assistant superintendents were invited to come to. So he'll just review the findings and briefly summarize, and then we'll take a vote to accept the audit so that we can then turn it into the various agencies that need our financial report. And you'll have to get the portable microphone. He's got this loud, booming voice, but he's going to need the mic so we get it recorded.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to come. You hear Natalie? Put that on. That works. We brought a copy of the report. The next few days we'll prepare a bound copy, a nice pretty one for you. But good to work with Robert and Seth, and they have a really good understanding, as you know, of the financial activities of the district, and they care. I mean, we can sense that they really care about what goes on and wanting the district to be successful. As mentioned, we met with the audit committee on Monday, reviewed in detail a few areas, some changes that have been made to comply with current accounting standards. And I believe the report demonstrates accountability and compliance with the many different requirements that are imposed when you get state and federal funding. And you'll see that this year you're within budget. The budget's your plan, and you followed that budget this year, and we're successful with that. And the balances that are available at the end of the year, they're appropriate. They're sufficient to be able to meet the needs that the district has and to meet those obligations and those promises that you've made. So we're pleased to be able to give our report on the financial statements. There's three pages in here that come from us, and the rest of it is prepared by Seth and by Robert and their staff. But our report on this document indicates that the financial statements present the balances and the activities for the year ending June of 2015, and they are following standards. So without any qualification, without any reservation, this report is an appropriate report. It tells the story of what happened in the last 12 months. I'll have Matt just quickly. There's also a smaller document that we're issuing. There's a few reports there, just the results, because when we come to the district, we go out and visit schools. We count kids. Does it take a CPA to count kids? I don't think so, but it's important that we measure the enrollments and the attendance properly, because that's a big driver on funding. So the state wants us to verify that information, that data. We also verify and look at adult education information and I think visiting the schools, it's not a big part of the district financially, but it's important. There's a lot of money being handled at the local level by a lot of different people, so we're reviewing that information. And the results of those tests and those visits, as well as the visit to the district, we didn't find anything of concern to report to you. Because there's some changes that are being made here in this document from prior practices, we do have a comment in here just to make sure that you are aware of the current accounting standards and that you make those efforts that are necessary to make sure you're following those standards. I think that, you know, Seth, he has those talents, those abilities, and I think he'll be able to help you with Robert to stay with those. If you think accounting wouldn't change, it's, you know, math, 2 + 2 is what, 4? And it's always gonna, hopefully it's always 4, but accounting, it's there's more of an art to it than we imagine, I guess. And trying to tell the story of what happened, standards do change, and we have to react to that. So we're trying to bring your report up to a more of a national level. It's met your needs locally, but I think because you're living in a world with your bonding and other things, we're trying to bring that up to a higher level. So we'll be your partners in that to help you have a good report that you can understand and understand what's happening with the district.
So as Ray mentioned, we, in addition to the financial aspects of the district, we looked at several other aspects, and you'll have a compliance report that breaks those things down. We do our audit in accordance with government auditing standards. Government auditing standards require that we review your internal control over financial reporting as well as compliance. So there's a report that talks about those things. As well as we look at your federal funding. This year, we looked at child nutrition program and the Title I program, and there's possible 14 compliance areas that we look at with each one of those programs that we test. And those programs are tested on a rotating basis, so next year it will be different programs, and we'll rotate through those. In addition to the federal compliance, we do an audit in accordance with the state compliance audit guide issued by the Utah State Auditor. And there's some general compliance requirements that we look at annually, and then there's some rotating steps that we'll look at, as well as reviewing your minimum school program compliance. In both the federal and the state compliance, there's no reportable findings or questioned costs that we need to communicate to you. So as Ray's mentioned on the financial, same with compliance, it's a very positive report, it's a very clean report, and it's been an enjoyment to work with the district. I am a product of speech pathology, so as they did their presentation, it's fun because, you know, I can talk. And that's a positive thing, right?
It works.
It works. But we really love working with school districts because we see the value that you provide, and we enjoy being on your team. Thank you.
Well, are there any questions? We have all been through the prior presentations, or most of us have, and so I hope most of the questions were answered then. If not, ask them now. Or do I have a motion to approve our audit report as presented? So moved by Doug Hirsch. Second by Rick. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. We now will turn the time over to Dale Pfister for the next 6 items.
Thank you, Superintendent Ford. If it's okay with you, may I bundle these together kind of as a group? They're literally one big policy separated out. But it's been almost 20 years since this policy has been revisited, and with changes in state law especially as it relates to busing school children and state board policy and then our own district procedures, that we found it necessary to revisit this and update and clean up a lot of things. And so I've submitted that to you for your approval on first reading.
Board, are there any questions, Dale, for concerning the policy 2300 to 2350? Do I have a motion to approve policies 2300, 2310, 20, 30, 40, and 50? Moved by Janice. Second by Mitzi. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? You made that really quick. You're trying to compete with Drew, aren't you?
Bill said, keep it short.
Well, we have come to the end of our agenda items. Board, do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Moved by Dean. Second by Mitzi. I doubt there will be any discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, and thank all of you for being with us this evening.
You bet, anytime.
Thank you.